for the department that engineer M. Gopal Krishan ji with us for second year Khosla endowment lecture. I also welcome Professor Manoranjan Parida, Deputy Director IIT Roorkee, Professor ML Kansal, Head Department of WRDM, and my faculty colleagues. As we all know that this is second year Khosla endowment lecture, and the topic of lecture is a new vision for system of water governance in India. Before moving ahead for this program, I request Professor and Head to say something about A.N. Khosla Memorial Lecture Series. Please, sir.
Namaskar, sabhi mahanubhavon ko mera namaskar. I, on behalf of the Department of WRDM IIT Roorkee, and on my personal behalf, welcomes you all to the second A.N. Khosla Endowment Lecture on a new vision for system of water governance in India. It is indeed our privilege to have Sri M. Gopal Krishnan ji, who has kindly agreed to deliver this talk and share his thoughts with us on this very important topic. I'm thankful to Professor M. Parida, Deputy Director, IIT Roorkee, who has kindly agreed to preside over the function. Let me brief you about Engineer A.N. Khosla, in whose memory we have initiated this lecture series. Engineer Ayodhyanath Khosla, born on 11 December 1892, was an eminent Indian engineer and politician. Dr. A.N. Khosla was the first Indian Vice Chancellor of the University of Roorkee. He was awarded the Padma Bhushan in 1954 and Padma Vibhushan in 1977. He was nominated to the Rajya Sabha in 1958 and later on in 1959 joined the Planning Commission of India. He was the 11th governor of Odisha during 1962 to 1968. Born in Jalandhar district of Punjab, he took his early education in Punjab and obtained the BA with honors from DAV College Lahore in 1912. He received the William Rettington Medal for standing first in BA examination. He then joined the Thompson College of Civil Engineering, now IIT Roorkee, in 1913. And graduated in 1916 as a civil engineer. He was awarded the Rai Bahadur Kanhaiya Lal Medal for Civil Engineering, for two gold medals from Punjab Engineering Congress in 1930 and 1936, Kennedy Medal from Punjab Irrigation Department in 1940, Medal from National Institute of Sciences in 1960, and Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Medal from INSA in 1974. In 1919, when the Indian Service of Engineers was established, he was assigned his first assignment for survey and investigations of Bhakhra Dam project. He spent 18 months on deputation to Mesopotamia as a commissioned officer. During this period, he developed the Khosla disk for precision leveling across rivers and wide valleys. In 1931, Engineer Khosla was deputed to the USA and Europe to study soil reclamation, water logging, and the latest techniques in dam design. In 1936, he wrote his magnum opus, The Design of Weirs on Permeable Foundation. This publication revolutionized the design of such structures in India and abroad. As an engineer, Engineer A.N. Khosla served the following prestigious positions. He was appointed as the first chairman of the Central Waterways Irrigation Navigation Commission, now known as the Central Water Commission, in 1945. He established the Central Water Power Research Station at Khadakbasla. He was instrumental in construction of Bhakhra Dam and later served as chairman of the Board of Consultants of Bhakhra Control Board until its commissioning in 1963. He undertook planning, design, and construction of Hirakud Dam, a major water resources project in India. He was president of the Institute of Engineers India from 1949 to 51. President INSA from 1960 to 1962. He was the founder president of the ICID 51 to 54, honorary president International Commission on Large Dams from 46 to 51, vice president IAHR and vice president Union of International Engineering Organization of UNESCO, etc. Before independence, he was awarded the title of Rai Sahib in 1929 and Rai Bahadur in 1933. He was instrumental in bringing about a number of agreements on negotiations for Indus water dispute with Pakistan. As educationist, he was the founder of the two specialized engineering departments, the Water Resources Development Training Center and the School of Research and Training in Earthquake Engineering, which have made the University of Roorkee internationally well known. Recognizing his contributions, he was awarded Doctorate of Engineering Honoris Causa by the Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, USA in 1956 and by the University of Roorkee in 1959. He was awarded the DSC by various universities such as University of Punjab, Sambalpur University, OUAT, Bhuneswar, Jadavpur University and IIT Delhi, etc. IIT Roorkee has named one of his guest house we know very well in his memory as the Khosla International House and constituted Dr. A.N. Khosla Award, which is well known to all of us. In fact, we are just the another lecture is being delivered by IIC Bangalore professor in the as the A.N. Khosla Award lecture. IIT Bhubaneswar has also named one of its hostel as A.N. Khosla Hall of Residences. He completed his life in 1984, and this department, our department, which is organizing this, feels proud in organizing this endowment lecture series. Feels proud in initiating this lecture series. Our department, earlier known as WRDTC, now known as WRDNM, was established by the first Prime Minister of India on 25th November 1955 at the University of Roorkee as an Asian African center to honor India's commitment at the Asian African Conference held in Bandung. This department has worked during the last 65 years with the strength of academicians and field engineers with long experience in planning, design, construction, operation and maintenance of water resources and hydropower projects, who help in implementation of application-oriented academic programs. The department is actively involved in research, design and extension activities in the area of water resources, hydropower and irrigation water management. The department has contributed in the development of almost all the major water resources projects like Bhakra, Hirakund, Teri, etc. and provides extension services for multiple purposes. We are also thankful to our director, Professor Ajit Chaturvedi, who has always been supporting such activities. He has wished a grand success to this program. So with this background, once again, I welcome you all to this second A.N. Khosla Endowment Lecture on a new vision for system of water governance in India. Thank you very much, and I welcome you to this lecture series.
Thank you, Professor Kansal. Before inviting Engineer M. Gopalakrishnan, I would like to tell you about him in brief. Although Gopalakrishnan sir needs no introduction in the field of water resources, but it's my duty to introduce Engineer Gopalakrishnan. He is an alumnus of IIT Roorkee. He obtained Khosla Gold Medal for ME Honours in 1977 and the University Gold Medal in PG Diploma in WRD. He had served Central Water Engineering Services for nearly 36 years and after retirement held the prestigious position of Secretary General, International Commission on Irrigation and Drainage for 9 years. His role to enhance ICID's image with global organizations like IWMI, ICOD, FAO, WWAP and Global Water Partnership was commendable. He is well known to the global community on water with his past link with World Water Council as one of its governor representing ICID. He had been contributing to other lead global groups including UN Water of UNESCO as a member of the Technical Advisory Committee in its inception and helped in shaping successive World Water Development reports in earlier decades. He is a recipient of Lifetime Achievement Award from the American Academy of Water Resource Engineers. He was inducted as a fellow of Indian National Academy of Engineers in 2011. Engineer Gopalakrishnan had in the recent past led Indian Water Resources Society as its president and received Lifetime Achievement Award in 2007. To strengthen the energy division of National Institute of Advanced Studies, Bengaluru, he was conferred the status of Honorary Adjunct Professor of NIAS Bangalore. Above all, he is a very humble person and we know him personally, that how he is kind for us as and when we needed, he always helped us. And now I request Engineer Gopal Krishnan for delivering the second A.N. Khosla Environment Lecture. Please, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Ashish Pandey. Distinguished friends, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen who are joining this web session. It is always a pleasure to meet the water fraternity with some of the challenging things that are before us with growing stress availability in the availability of water. So when I was invited, I thought of choosing this topic being of great relevance, especially for a country like India, where we are almost bogged down with a lot of water disputes and a situation where it looks that a smooth progress in the development of water sector is next to impossible. Well, that's why I chose as to how even we can have a relook on the system of water governance in the country. Prior to that, let me add a few words because this is in commemoration of Dr. A.N. Khosla. I am so fortunate that I am able to join this community of distinguished lecturers who could deliver the Khosla Memorial Lecture to fellow colleagues. Actually, I belong to Central Water Commission, which was initiated by Dr. Khosla. He was also the initiator of ICID, where I could contribute in the subsequent decade as its Secretary General. His contribution to Patra Dam, which was mentioned while people were trying to introduce Dr. A.N. Khosla, is immense, and it gave courage to a lot of fellow engineers in the subsequent decades that we could even boldly think of a 272-meter high dam, embankment dam, which is the world's highest in theory. And as one of the Central Water Engineering Services officer, I had the pleasure of contributing it at a time when such challenges were not earlier met by our own design group. We can go on adding a lot about Dr. A.N. Khosla, but that would take away the time from the topic that we are trying to concentrate. So suffice to say, my deep respects and regards to this noble man who, like Dr. M. Visveswaraya, is they are the gifts for us, the engineers in the country. Well, gentlemen, the topic that I have chosen is slightly difficult, so I would try to go through certain slides so that it facilitates the discussions on the topic which is before us. Well, we can, quite a few slides could come on the type of the situation that would prevail in future, but suffice to bring in essentially food requirements. About 80% of the water in our country is diverted for irrigation. And actually, if we see the growing population, by 2050, we need almost 450 million tons of food requirements. And this has to be met with sufficient water availability, because irrigated agriculture alone can assure quality, certainty in food production for the requirements of the country. Rainfed has its own role, but there is uncertainty. And we are doing fine. We have reached about 300 million right now, and we should be in a position to do that. And simultaneously, there are efforts to improve the efficiency in application of water in almost all the sectors. Notwithstanding, even bracketing that efficiency improvement and efficient management of water resources, we find that we would not be in a position to satisfactorily meet the demands with respect to various sectors, which is captured in this particular slide. We find that over 50 years from the dawn of this century, the water requirements are almost doubling. And notwithstanding certain new factors that has come in, like climate change, and in energy sector, the use of non-conventional energy, especially the renewables. So the broadly, these figures, which have been worked out by a team in the Ministry of Water Resources a decade back, it may not alter to a certain extent, because even the solar energy requirements may match with some of the estimates that has been projected for others, and the set target for non-conventional energy are substantially high, and we can take for granted that we have to prepare ourselves for providing about 1,447 billion cubic meter of water each year for meeting with various water demand. Now, things are gradually changing, unlike the earlier decades in the past century and even up to 70s or so. It was development that was getting focused, but now managing the developed water resources is also getting focused. So the new technology that is being vociferously advocated by almost all who are concerned with water, earlier it used to be engineers, but then now there are almost all the professions that have significant contributions to the water sector, and the IWRM concept, which in a country where still development is on its pathway, we can call it IWDRDM as a concept. So given the projections, we are also thinking, we have a national water policy, I will touch upon that later. Long distance water transfer from water rich to water short basins are also being contemplated. This more popularly, it is known as ILR, and there are serious action being taken to look at this effectively, co-opting almost all the states who are essentially to play their own role in respect of water development and management. Now, acknowledging the need for taking water highest in the country's agenda, recently our government had even named the ministry that was handling the water resources as Jal Shakti. It is now Jal Shakti Mantralaya. Jal Shakti for Indians, Shakti you are all quite aware of. We have to see how to really provide teeth to the Jal Shakti Mantralaya, or the governance at the highest level in the country. And they have a challenge before them and how they could indeed achieve it. And given the current situations, we find there is now a lot of need for integration because of the interdependence. Like it could be between land and water, it could be surface water and groundwater integration, it could be water quality and water quantity, and in a basin, in a river basin, it could be effectively link the overall interests of the upstream as well as the downstream without intruding into the essential needs of each other, and linkages even right up to the water joining the sea, the freshwater coastal water systems too. So the management is in fact itself moving towards integrating all these things. Management of integration also ask for mainstreaming national economy, coordinating between sectors, promote public, private sector participation too, with sufficient social acceptance. So involving all stakeholders is the big challenge, and achieving the satisfaction of everyone who participated in this. With regard to water, you know, there was a time when there was more focus on development and things were easier for engineers. Now the challenge is how to face certain obstacles, and this obliges us to look critically into the water in Indian constitution and the provisions therein. So there is a need for a holistic river management act, and some works were going on in which I too was intensely got associated between 2012 to 14. So my object is to place before you some of the provisions which are also in consideration in the ministry, and how to strengthen and in a parallel forum bring before those who are having concern on water, especially IWRS. It is a sort of a community of not only engineers concerned with water management or water development, but also almost every citizen who has an interest in water. So I thought discussions on this topic in a forum like the one which you are doing would help the government's own fast track effort. It is a parallel track effort. So I am trying to bring in before you some of the shareables that are available. It is some are available in the Union Jal Shakti Ministry's own website. So the ministry was getting into examining the river basin management aspects in a big way, and there was a committee because it was the legal aspects. It was headed by retired Justice Ted Dwabia, Trilok Singh Dwabia ji, and I was a member. And this particular committee could do quite a bit. Before that, for most of you should be well aware of this, but a quick run through the provisions that are found in our constitution. Water is in the list 2 of the Indian constitution, which is dealing with the states, entry 17. And entry 56 in the union list provides space for the union also with regard to regulation and development of interstate rivers and river valleys, to the extent to which such regulation and development under the control of the union is declared by parliament by law. This is important, kindly note it, it would come back later, to be expedient in public interest. Otherwise, all that concerns water by entry 17, water supplies, irrigation and canals, drainage, embankments, storage, water power projects, they are all assigned to the respective states in the union. There is sometimes, you know, the disputes arise, and in such cases, the constitution also brought in an article that could look into dispute resolution mechanism. So Article 262 provides that Parliament can by law provide for the adjudication on any dispute with respect to use, distribution or control of the waters of any interstate river or river valley. However, there was a caveat. Notwithstanding anything in this constitution, Parliament may by law provide that neither the Supreme Court nor any other court shall exercise jurisdiction in respect of any such dispute or complaint as is referred to in Clause 1. So important to note that Parliament, the elected representatives of the people, they have a major role in case of any complexity with regard to water matters to decide. We thought that in the earlier slides, the union has a certain role. States, basically, they are the ones concerned with water. But in 1992, the amendment to constitution brought in more realistically down to the bottom, the roles of the panchayat and municipality. And that way, panchayats can deal with minor management, watershed development, drinking water and maintenance at community assets, like tanks and so on. And Dealing with municipalities, another 12th schedule brought in water supply of domestic, industrial and commercial purposes as a role to be assigned to the municipalities. So more or less, constitution has enabled, it has fixed functional responsibilities almost to all from top to bottom in the country so that there is effective water management. Now, when we look at the macro formation on with regard to water governance structure, national water resources, this is at the apex, in which the Prime Minister himself is chairing it, and all the union ministries and the ministers concerned which have water-related interest, they are members. Ministry of Jal Shakti's minister will be its member secretary. And all the chief ministers of the states, the lieutenant governors of union territories and so on, they all form the members. So this is the apex body that more or less governs the way the water should be handled, managed in the country. One of the functions of this National Water Resource Council is to lay down the national water policy and review it from time to time. So the first NWP or water policy was brought in 1987, and after about a decade plus five, there was a revision and a third one came up in 2012. And National Water Policy of 2012 acknowledged that there is a need to evolve a national framework law. More or less, you know, you would have seen in other instances, like there is an European water framework law. The India has evolved a national framework law as a sort of an umbrella statement of the general principles. The national water framework, it was only in the current decade, commencing with 2012. This was initiated, and this was first Dr. Hashim, then Dr. Allard, and later Dr. Mahishra as a review committee chairman. They all have looked into and brought before all of us a sort of broad national water framework law, which could help the governance of water. While this committee could look into the technical aspects as well as the other managerial aspects, we can't ignore the legal side. That's how Government of India in the Ministry of Water Resources simultaneously constituted another committee under the chairmanship of Justice Jinjar Singh Doabia to study the activities that are required for optimal development of a river basin and changes in the existing River Board Act 1956 for achievement of the same. More or less, the River Board Act 1956, which is still in vogue, it was not, we will come back to that later. How come we are not able to make the desired progress in respect of certain vexing issues in the water? So that was more or less the task before the Tejinder Singh Doabia committee, and the report of the committee containing the River Basin Management Bill 2013 was submitted, and I will more or less get into the core contents of this in this present talk. The other two talks on water framework as well as national water policy, they are all well known. It could be having its own sessions, but they are all mostly indicating the plausible, laudable goals that we should keep in mind while we work in the water sector. But enabling mechanisms availability, one has to critically examine, and it is there that the legal aspects assumes somewhat a premier position. Otherwise, disputes arise and there is cases in court, water disputes are plenty. We find that the basin approach shall enable better implementation of RBM and ensure that current demands for water are met without jeopardizing the ability of future generations to meet theirs. Water is the is one subject where the political boundaries, it doesn't quite help. The basin approach is rather far superior compared to the administrative boundaries of a state or so on. And this was realized in a growing manner right from 60s and 70s internationally. Prior to that, it was all river valley development, and that they found provided new challenges. Overall, it could result in advancing the countries in social and economic development goals in ways that do not compromise the sustainability of vital ecosystems. This recognition also is post-70s. The RBM approach shall need, of course, revamping the institutional systems so as to help an all-inclusive approach in managing water, and it should be such that existing systems of administering water could morph over in an efficient manner. This is very, very important. See, in cases, our country had almost all well-established systems with regard to water governance. We are well aware of it, the states, the irrigation, water supply, and other specific departments. And in case something different is being asked for, how to morph over? So this will be also something that could come up in the latter part of the talk. Now, the Doapia High Level Committee was a multidisciplinary one, and it was supposed to review the existing provisions and issues, particularly that impact water governance, study the prerequisites and actions needed for enabling optimal development of river basins. So this is very important, and it also tacitly implies that in case the optimal development is not possible, deviation from optimal to a suboptimal level, how much it could cost the nation. That is an inference. And to bring such changes as may be required in the existing River Board Act. So more or less, that is a River Board Act, but it is existing, but it is not able to do something that we will see later. And this is asking as to how to bring out such changes in that act. So the committee is like this. I was one of its members. It was multidisciplinary. Former Special Secretary S. Manoharan at that time, he was also actively participating. Late B.P. Das, he is well known from Odisha for his contributions in environmental or eco-sector care with regard to water use, etc. So he was in. Sri Bogle, he was ex-director general of Wat Balmi, so he could bring in expertise with regard to irrigated agriculture and water management. And late Videh Upadhyay, in fact, this gentleman is too young. He was one of the best contributors for the committee. He knows all about water. In fact, his father also was a Central Water Engineering Services officer who is still there. Unfortunately, we are not having amidst ourselves Videh due to some unfortunate thing. He is no more. And the government officers who were belonging to CWC, National Water Development Agency, and Ministry of Water Resources were also kept as members with the ministry's Pradeep Kumar. He is now retired. He was member secretary. Sri Pandyaji is now Secretary General ICID. Subsequently, he took over CWC chairman, and Rajesh Kumar also was CWC chairman. So we all pondered as to how to go about the issues or the terms of reference that was before them. The terms of reference was to identify the main ingredients for a comprehensive RVD plan under a legal framework for effective implementation, and to come out with appropriate structure for an Interstate River Valley Development Act and recommend a legal framework to facilitate smooth implementation of River Valley Plan. This is going on like that. It also, some of the points where the terms of reference to suggest means of ensuring accountability of the states in the faithful implementation of RVD plans, delineate responsibilities of GOI and state governments, also indicate the extent to which some of the responsibilities can be delegated to the states without compromising the lead role of the central government. Especially this is crucial in respect of interstate rivers. Suggests the legal provision for ensuring the smooth flow of all the data required for planning and implementation. So the committee took stock of the fact that this is well known, a number of judgments by Honorable Supreme Court in recent decades call upon the states to conserve and preserve water resources and share it, this is more important, to other core riparian, given the acute shortage of water and river flows and the decline in groundwater level. Increasingly, it is felt that the existing legislation on water are inadequate in meeting the aspirations of the states. Even the states, their own aspirations, the existing legislations are coming in the way. And it is acknowledged that a new legislation that enables the states which share river basins should be useful if well drafted. And it would be expedient in the public interest that the central government take under its control the regulation and development of interstate rivers and river valleys to the extent required to enable optimal water management. This was there already in the 1956 Act, but it was not happening, and so it gets reiterated in that. Now, earlier I mentioned briefly, Entry 56 provides the states sufficient powers to deal with water, and the Riverboard Act was enacted in pursuance of this Entry 56 of the Article 246. Center had a role in respect of interstate rivers, but this Riverboard Act in respect of interstate rivers, the committee found it has almost fallen into disuse, as no river board has been ever constituted under this act. The committee suggested that it should be repealed. As to why it has not been possible to do something, we will come to that later. Some key limitations discernible in the River Board Act were absence of concepts like basin, sub-basin, integrated river basin management or IWR, and river basin master plan. It was dealing with valley, river valley development, RVD, which was a concept in 1920s, 30s, like TVA and so many authorities elsewhere, where even in India, we started with the DVC, Damodar Valley Corporation. Over a period, this terminology is no longer as much in vogue. It is more or less, it is integrated water river, water management, river basin management. So the integrated river basin management has several connotations, which is itself a big lecture. Anyway, we had found that in the River Board Act, all these are all missing because it was globally emerging subsequently. No mandatory nature of the provisions, absence of any political representation in river boards. This is another lacuna in it. And lack of mechanism of dispute redressal or enabling binding provision, it was found in that. The review exercise by the committee resulted that it may not suffice just to amend or visit or patchwise suggest some changes to the old 1956 River Basin Act. It worked hard and brought out a new River Basin Management Act in lieu of the earlier one after it's getting scrapped. The draft has finalized in terms of reference assigned to the special MOWR committee chair that I will briefly give in the following slides. And I had been responsible in contributing to this committee in a sufficient way. This act that we have drafted, which is now available and is in processing, contains about 9 basic sections and 2 schedules, a preamble, a definition all about water and sharing and so on, principles, then defining interstate road basins in the country. And this is now crucial. Establishment on constitution of river basin authorities. These are powerful entities when it comes to water management or water governance. And how would they go about that is river basin master plans, this was brought in. And later it went on to even detail the powers and functions of RBAs. And in case there are disputes, how to go about the resolution of them and how make it more or less sustainable. The river basin authorities should be in a position over a period to have its own financial as well as other sustainability. It contained even paragraphs on funds, accounts, and other matters with two schedules that bring in the concern river basin. A quick going through, these are available in the ministry's website. You can get it. Or even these slides would be available for you to digest in your leisure, so I'll be fast. The Act proposed would facilitate the establishment of RBAs for the regulation and development of interstate rivers and river basins once it get passed, so it has to go through the Parliament. Principles governing the river basin development, management and regulation would fall in line with national water policy. You see, we do have laudable national water policy and assisting that national water framework, but these are desirables. The center or the unitary, there is no teeth to them in case it is not being faithfully followed. And it is where one has to look at how to enable some sort of what you call overall supervision or oversight, participation, cooperation, equitable, sustainable utilization of water, conjunctive as well as integrated management. These would be forming part of all the exercises. And water as a common pool community resource, it would be basic. And there would be simultaneous attention on demand management. So the proposed river basin authorities shall commence its work to begin with evolving the RBM plans or master plans. And this is in tune with the national framework for water. It would take into account all the river basin characteristics, including anthropogenic interventions, identification of protected areas, social, cultural flows. Some of these aspects like environment, the social, cultural flows, these are recent demands of the society, which has to be effectively accounted for. Groundwater and protected aquifers. And notwithstanding all this, we have to get into some aspects which are sometimes people try to not get into it. A summary survey of existing pricing policies and economic analysis, a fair assessment of the effects of existing legislations, and an economic analysis for optimal allocation and the notional cost of deviation from optimal. In many cases in water sector, we may not be able to achieve this laudable optimal goal. And as to how much we can deviate, that could be indicated if there is a fair assessment of such deviations from optimal, where a development is deferred or moderated to a suboptimal level to the cost of the society. When it comes to governance, this is something crucial for my talk. This is the logic behind this is a two-tier water administration. River basin authorities, it would have a two-tier system. The upper one, the governing council, is supreme. And it would all be by the participant states. Together, they would form a governing council. This will have, from each basin state, their chief ministers, or Minister of Water Resources, as the case may be, and it would have representation of MP from each state, one MLA, two representatives of Panchayat, Zilla Parishad, Chief Secretaries, one representative from Water Users Association, and urban and local bodies like municipalities, and two independent experts to be nominated by the state government. So it is a very broad-based council which should try to decide on how to go about the river basin itself. to be aided by three independent experts to be nominated by the central government, and the member secretary, who shall be the CEO or of the executive board, next slide would bring it, he would be a rank of additional secretary to Government of India or member of Central Water Commission. The second tier is the real executive board. Its constitution would be such as to have a CEO of the rank of additional secretary to Government of India or member Central Water Commission. And from the basin states concerned, the secretaries, it could be water resources or flood control, secretaries of agriculture, power, environment. And then the professionals, like each basin state's engineer in chief, pollution control board chief, then state groundwater board participant, and managing director or member secretary of water supply and sewerage, and disaster management authorities member secretary. Regional directors of CGB will be in this, and one person to represent NGO and one expert dealing with river basin and water resource management to be nominated by the state government of each of the basin states. And member secretary for this board will be the concerned chief engineer of the CWC. They have a wide network with the field formations of the Central Water Commission in the field, whose present roles would be enhanced to contribute to this committee or to the River Basin Authority. A brief about the Governing Council functions. It would be supreme. It would approve the River Basin Master Plan. So more or less here, the power to think about the River Basin Master Plan is given to the Master Plan, the River Basin Interstates themselves. The center then accepts what they come up with to facilitate implementation of the approved River Basin Master Plan, to make recommendation in relation to the coordination of the basin activities with view to resolve conflict among them. The conflict is internally resolved. That is very important. To make recommendations for conservation, control, and optimum utilization of water resources. And after the consideration, that is to forward every approved scheme made under this act to the government's interest, it goes to the respective state government and then to the center with such advice as required and or solicited to undertake measures for executing the scheme, to allocate among the government's interested the cost of executing any scheme prepared by the RBA. The function further continues on clearance of the water source project reports, to lay down policies, to prepare water account, to see pollution is controlled, and any other matter that is supplemental or incidental. The recommendation of the River Basin Authority shall be final and binding on all parties. You know, the legal associates, they are very clear as to what to suggest to almost avoid the present type of stalemate situation. Supporting the Governing Council, that is an executive board. I forgot to tell the Governing Council, the chair of the Governing Council, with all chief ministers of the states, participant states as members, would be by rotation one of the chief ministers of the basin state, and this rotation is envisaged in the recommendation. Here it could be more or adjusted as the situation demands. Executive board, this is primarily a sort of function that would handle all that which is technical, administration, and so on, under the guidance of the Governing Council. They formulate River Basin Master Plan, they prepare schemes for multipurpose or otherwise, they ensure compliance of the decisions taken in the Governing Council in respect of RBA Master Plan. This compliance is important, and they maintain, regularly update a comprehensive water database. This is very important given the climate change situation that we face now. And to conduct comprehensive scientific survey, investigation, assessment of water resources, and also monitor the progress of the measures undertaken in the implementation of the master plan. They acquire all disposed property, both movable and immovable. More or less, assets should be under their control. like the dams, reservoirs, the canals, and so on, undertake such investigation and surveys and other measures, inspect any work undertaken by any government interested concerning regulation and development of interstate river basin, conduct and coordinate research on various aspects relating to water conservation. They also have powers for efficient discharge of functions, collect such topographical, geological, hydrological, all technical details, and publish statistics and so on. And the Central Water Commission would provide technical support in the matter of preparation of RBM. This is a central role. Now comes the dispute resolution. In case of disputes, persuasion, conciliation, and mediation would be the first step towards dispute resolution arising out of the recommendations of RBA. Only if that mode fails, reference under Interstate River Water Dispute Act 56 can be resorted to by those who are aggrieved. As I told, the draft act also suggests the mechanism for funding accounts and other matters, and it is quite, this has to be placed before the parliament, especially the annual report of the East River Basin. And the central government may, after due appropriation made by parliament by law on this behalf, pay to the River Basin Authority in each financial year such sums as the central government may consider necessary for the performance of the functions of the RBA under this act. So it is something overarching. And the committee suggested to begin with, we can have about 12 basins. We have listed that. This is in the alphabetical order. Otherwise, there are bigger basins ranking behind the smaller basins. So these are listed. Almost all the country gets covered by this. The proposed act is in line. This is very important. The national water framework, it is very like national water policy. It is a sort of a governing suggestions. And even that national water framework, it brings in chapter four that integrated river basin development man suggests that each basin state shall make best efforts to integrate appropriately the management of waters with the management of all natural, agricultural, human resources attached therewith, taking into account social, economic, institutional factors. And every water-related activity, any part of the river basin or sub-basin of a large basin, including water projects proposed at the river basin or sub-basin by the concerned entity, shall be undertaken with due regard to the concerned technical things like hydrology, land use, interlinkage of quality, quantity, and holistic view of the relationship of all such activities one another. This is important interdependency. So what I would like to point out is the National Water Framework endorses the RBM approach. It has even spelled out clearly, these are quotes from that, establishment of RBA for each interstate river basin that is recommended. And then each river basin authority should prepare a master plan under its jurisdiction, comprising all the information that are requisite. And more importantly, we see the river basin master plan shall take due account of and be coordinated plans for national economic social development. This is important. Water development cannot stand in isolation unless it also is in tune with the national economic and social development and general plans for land use, rural, urban, and plan for aquifer rejuvenation and environmental protection, and so on. This most of the water engineers are very well conversant of. The river basin master plan at all stages shall remain in the public domain. This should be one of the important things so that the public participation is encouraged, and it should be professionally a superior document. Academia can play a role once this type of enabling mechanism is there, and they can come up with good suggestions. All decisions and actions on water resources of the river basin, including implementation, shall progressively conform to RBM plan. And last but not the least, this is most important. Interbasin of interstate river water shall be considered on the basis of merits and historical use of each case after evaluating the environmental, economic, and social impacts of such transfer with the time. Well, almost I am through with that. Suffice in my concluding remarks if I tell you that we have a national water policy, we have a national water framework law, and then still we find that quite a few things which are achievable, we are not in a position to make progress. One typical thing is there is a very high level committee, special committee on interlinking of rivers, and it is almost a decade now that we thought of at least taking up one interlinking project as a case example to learn from that and then expand to quite a few other schemes. And sufficient progress has not been possible, even though it has a similar wide constituency, including it is chaired by the Union Water Resources Minister, and almost all the states are having its ministers in charge of water resources as its member, and the bureaucrats and technocrats of center as well as states, they are members of the committee. Every time we get bogged down to issues which are somewhat, somehow, if I want to put it plainly, the broader objectives with regard to national interests that get lost sight of in respect of local or sometimes the parochial and what I accept and things like that. That is somewhat unfortunate. And that is where if center has to move very effectively, the additional secretary at that time, Manoharan, he talked to the committee, how can we have teeth? There is no teeth. We have, so that type of situation, how to change this? So the legal committee was trying to put more efforts and drafted, it is a very long document, and I wish those of you who are keen must go through that. And then first and foremost, agree that this should be brought before the parliament and suitable things done. And there could be many questions. In these web type of sessions, I am not able to see the faces or hands or that thing. If I open the chat box, I can't run through my slides. So I expect that many questions are quite likely as to why a RBM Act to be enacted. They may wonder as to whether the reforms in water sector could be accomplished even by the present systems in vogue, that which is well established for decades. Won't just national water policies, national water framework not suffice? Well, the answer is given in the following three slides, more or less why we have to ponder. The first is the legal framework for constituting an interstate river basin organization is contained within the constitution itself. And the constitution of India has vested powers on the Parliament of India for the regulation and development of interstate rivers and river valleys, that is further expanded by concerned article. In pursuance of this, we enacted the River Board Acts right way back in 56, nearly 60 years back. However, we see that no single river board was in fact constituted under the River Board Act earlier promulgated, but the states have not responded to the legal space for river boards created under the River Boats Act 56, and this has meant that the act has fallen into disuse. This is largely due to the fact that Section 4(1) of the Act, the exercise of power of Government of India to establish a river board, was incidental to a request received from state government. You see, the government cannot suo motu act. It has to receive a request from the state government, and no state government ever made a request under the said action of the River Board Act. So almost that is how it has gone into disuse. The River Board Act 1956 also does not provide for any river basin planning. You know, those concepts were completely absent. Projects were plan as individual projects in Arua, the viability of establishing, and all those days it was planned totally in a different way. The holistic hydrology was not playing any role, and that way integrated planning, development, management of water resources of the river basin were not contemplated explicitly at the time of enactment of RBA 56. Understandably, the IWRM was not a concept of that era. The concept of IWDRM, more commonly known as IWRM, attained importance due to the growing water scarcity worldwide in later decades, impacting highly populated countries more and more. The IRBM concept shall take on board IWRM to the extent possible. Besides, all the more, in a broader sense, integrated resource management concepts aligning to NDP, the National Development Goals, would be the aim. And with the Governing Council's role in approving RB Master Plan in tune with this, we should be able to get a better solution for our problems. The IRBM approach shall ensure that the current demands for water are met without jeopardizing the ability of future generations to meet theirs. This is sustainability goal. It would act as a catalyst to promote long distance water transfer in case of dire necessity. Overall, morphing over to RBA approach is likely to help us to advance countries' social and economic development in ways that do not compromise the existing legal and constitutional provisions to a significant extent, factoring the national interest with states' interest in case of divergence. Easier to follow the water framework, a win-win situation for all the states. Well, sirs, this is what I thought I and now it is all open to organizers. I don't know how many
thank you very much for a very nice coverage of the topic. I know it is a very complex topic, and it is not that easy to understand the legalities and the legal issues. You have so nicely covered these legal issues. I think every one of us should know that aspect, particularly the integrated water resources management aspects, the legal position of India, and then the interdependence and the management of the integration aspect. And then you have also discussed the river basin management planning, like the economic, social, environmental aspects. I was just wondering, sir, one or two points, I think before Ashish Pandey takes over that one, two points were coming to my mind. One was about that how to deal with the international river basins, because India is covered by the so many other countries. And we have the problems with the international rivers. So is there any system of addressing that aspect there? And second is, probably we are talking about the integrated water resource management and sustainable development of the water resources. Can we think of the society as the water sensitive? So how to make the society as water sensitive, because we have the wider range of the society at large with different water resource availability.
Excellent. Thank you. In case of other questions from the audience also, you can consolidate. I would request Ashish to kindly help in that. For your questions, one is on international river sharing, and number two on more or less creating awareness, water sensitivization of the common public. Both are crucial. In fact, they have been well addressed in the national water framework too. And what I would suggest, the existing systems are also especially on sensitizing the water efficiency or water use, and awareness creation with regard to water availability and water quality. These are best handled by independent groups dealing with water, and they are doing a marvelous job. There is a lot of public participation in this regard. With regard to the international rivers and how to go about it, It is somewhat complex. If we are in a position to create, like in the river basin authorities, we have envisaged two river basins for Ganga, one upper and one lower. And depending on that river basin authority's perceptions, we would be in a position to consolidate all member states' interests. And when we take them on board while discussing the water sharing issues with the rivers, it has to be, you know, addressed bilaterally with the concerned countries, which is dealing with like Pancheshwar. We are already in dialogue with Nepal, and as it is, UP is also intensely involved, being immediate downstream riparian states. But we can bring in a lot more, and these things are achievable. And this is exactly where a formulation of a different type of governance system in India with regard to river basins, river basin assets, river basin management, that is going to help a great deal. So that is what I would try to tell. I am now finding in my screen itself some questions. One question seems to be from Idhaya to everyone. I mentioned the okay, I would address this question too. The question one is best left to the present day administrators in the ministries, both at center and the respective state. Second, he is asking about the interlinking rivers for effective water management at national scale. Could you comment on the status of this ambitious scheme at the central level? Well, this is being considered and it is being revised. There is a very high-level committee, which is chaired by the Union Minister for Jal Shakti. And in that, the state ministers are also there. And I did, in the passing, mention about one of the links that was given. Importance and sufficient progress has been made. And it is Ken-Betwa link. And the candidate states are UP, MP, and Rajasthan too. They are in dialogue. It is an advanced stage. In fact, there also as to how to go about implementing that national project of interlinking one link. It has to be, that is being studied. It would all come through and it would have some impact on the way we are trying to take. If the RBAs come first, it would be the responsibility of the RBAs, and probably the RBAs then consider, once the project is accepted for implementation, the concerned states would try to execute its part, and the grants would be received from the national exchequer to them and so on. So those are mechanisms. And I also find the questions from Idhaya. It is great to have RBAs which might resolve interstate water sharing issues. Could you show some light on the challenge and timeline on implementation? Timeline, it is already under serious consideration, and hopefully Basant Ji, our central government, is able to make good progress. As of now, the entire mechanism is persuasive. You try to sit in those meetings, and many times the state's representatives, they are also having certain feeding from the states back, and they are not enabled or equipped to deviate from the stand that was asked by the concerned states. Some of the interlinks, though sufficiently advanced progress is made, over small issues, things are getting almost a stalemate situation. That was Western Link, like Daman Ganga, Pinjal, and Narmada Tapi links. So we have to, it is there one has to ponder as to how to resolve the existing things. Even after the constitution of a very high level committee, it is not able to achieve as much expected success. It was constituted under the directions of the Supreme Court. As it is, there are a lot of bottlenecks, and at the instance of the Supreme Court, the frequency, or it is meeting very regularly. But in order to make progress some more, we have to change the entire water sector governance processes in some other form. And it is where I hope that the RBM Act should help. And that can be the Dobia committee at that point of time itself tried to give a sort of a white paper that could inform the parliament members. It is something where, you know, several ministries are concerned, and water resource ministry might have to also do it in consultation with law ministry and a few others, energy and others. So mostly this is the current day administrators and bureaucrats, apart from that, the technocrats in Central Water Commission, NWDA and others who they try to take care of. I know that they are taking very good care and intensely working, because I participate even now in some of their committees, thanks to their kind invitation. Any other questions?
Professor Ashish, you can carry on. And if there is any question from the audience, even now they can ask. Any query or any question?
I have posted two questions in the chat box. Probably I was late, so may I ask now?
Yeah, sure.
So, Gopal Krishna Sahib,
I am hearing you, Sharad.
Yeah, interlinking of river, which is a subject close to your heart. We were also associated in preparing the DPR of Cane Betwa Link, and then subsequently through several committees. But now it appears that this scheme is not likely to materialize, at least in the details it was conceived by NWDA. So in your opinion, do we have some alternative like a mini interlinking of river, which takes some links which are non-commercial and which are easy to handle? Another related thing is the cost of interlinking was already quite high, and in the intervening period, I think the cost has risen several times. So do you think that these links will be still financially viable?
You see, Sharadji, I would answer it this way. We have to go back to my initial slide, in which we were trying to take note of that requirements by 2050 would be about 1440 billion cubic meter. And even after harnessing all the projects, if, you know, it also on individual project basis has to undergo a lot of regular checking processing, we get about 1200 billion cubic meter of water. We have still a deficit of about 200 billion cubic meter, and it is where the interlinking of rivers or the long distance water transfer is going to step in to help. So more or less, the at margin, when you want to fulfill that deficit, and this deficit is even after all our energy cost spent on efficiency improvement, that itself tries to release locally some water. But to get that 200 billion cubic meter extra water at margin in the demand curve, you have to spend, and that has to be in a very prudential manner. That's where even the usage of water, some legal provisions, financial, it should be, it may be charged, the water, even for agriculture, so that there is prudential use apart from efficient use of water in irrigation. Those things are applied. So in a sense, I would try to tell you the cost aspect. When you talk, that cost is more or less the financial cost. But the opportunity cost of not doing that is going to be quite substantial in decades to come. Because when you look at sustainability, if the population probably gets stabilized at 1.8 billion, and that time when we need the water, that which is approximately estimated by the Standing Committee of the Ministry of Water Resources at 1440 billion cubic meter, we have to think of long-term solutions. And in case, you see, when people where there is no water, take for instance Middle East, take for instance some cases in Egypt, where everything is dependent on sea saline water consumption, those cost of water are quite substantial. Definitely one should know that long distance water transfer water costs much more, but when the water stress is such that the country cannot afford to withstand the effects of those water stress in those areas where something positive can be done in accordance with the national development plans, then we shouldn't hesitate. The cost at margin of achieving something is always quite high, and that cost is only financial, but opportunity cost it is negligible. So best is leaving it to the financial experts to analyze some of the things, cost of not doing. Probably, for instance, if Pancheshwar multipurpose project was, it is implementable, it was implemented in 60s, several costs in respect of several other sectors like defense and all could have been avoidable expenditure today. So how do you compare? Same thing with some of the developments in Brahmaputra. Take, for instance, Dihang project, which is no more there. Now it has been split into three in respect of Port Subansiri. And so we have the lost opportunity, the costs are quite substantial. If you don't do, you are gone. And the net effect is you may have financial powers to import, say, for instance, the deficit food or whatever other needs, because you may have money power, but the self-sufficiency, Atmanirbharta goal is gone. The money power can get you only when the other side also yields to your request. If they put a sort of ban on export of certain things to our country, we are at a loss. And so these things take us beyond the water sector, so I won't be able to take you there. But suffice to note that the mere financial cost, which commonly we people try to take into account in the preparation of DPR, that doesn't suffice. So social benefit and cost analysis is quite important. And when you do that, some of the costs that we are supposedly incurring financially, they would be zero. Like idle labor, when they get engaged and we are providing jobs for them, the cost at national level for engaging an ideal labor is zero. But in financial accounting, it would figure. So let me not take you diverting from this. It should be possible to go for interlinking of rivers. Once we have to more or less try to take out, the people should come out of looking things in a very parochial and narrow sense. National interests are getting geopardized, and if water, instead of being a conflict subject, become water for cooperation rather than water for conflict, it would help a great deal in cementing people, states, and the nation would be able to progress at large. And in fact, ILR is one of the most effective tools for cementing the nation and spreading the will of cooperation. But that is where other civil societies and others should step in to help the cause.
Thank you. That brings just one more related question, that rather than proposing this scheme as interlinking of river, if it is justified in terms of integrated flood and drought management, do you think the acceptability will be more and chances of success will be more? Because this is a
technocrats can give lot of good names. See, the interlinking of rivers was simple. Interlinking of mines, interlinking of, it was evolved about two decades back when we were trying to develop a lot of road network across the country, the east, west, and quadrilateral, and so on. Remember about Atal Bihari Vajpayee Ji. So link the minds, link the rivers, link the people. So that is how the interlinking of rivers. Otherwise, that word was not there when the technocrats were trying to evolve the plans. It was interbasin water transfer, IWT. And later on, we added that it can't be treated in isolation, and we should have a sort of, it all started, basically, it was initially KL Ross concept was not south link, but we found then there was a east-west link also, and the quadrilateral, that was one of the other contributions. But the NWD, in which you were very deeply associated, and sometimes I think you had the opportunity to hold the director generalship also, that was going more specifically on water balance, and it was not getting into deeper on the project implementation was a stage that should come up later. So NWDA was to provide a perspective plan which is realistic, and that is how the interbasin water transfers were proposed, and a sort of combining all that together so that the water resources sector can look at a national project of importance came in. And in 2002, when Suresh Prabhu was trying to guide it as chairman of the task force, we had certain requests from Northeast, and mostly it was not quite connected with interlinking, in the sense that it went far beyond the Tista link that was to be done from Brahmaputra's thing. So their whole thing was a sort of flood management as to how to go about it. So more or less, it was envisaged that we can expand the scope and enhance the cost so that it takes into care where it is concerned, flood management or drought management, and even coastal freshwater management and so on. So more or less, I would tell you that it is a sort of broader idea to evolve country's overall water management plan. And the subsets are what would be each RBA's master plan. So the difference between the individual project-wise development and the master plan, it looks the basin as a whole, and then it just tries to consider how a basin could cater to its deficit with the help of adjoining basin, or even the one next to the adjoining, that's where long distance water transfer comes. This is keeping in mind that the nation is one. If that idea is lost, we cannot give it to the neighbor. Now things are going so worse that even within the state, there is a sort of upstream downstream conflict. For example, Netravati Kaveri link was proposed in the national perspective plan, but the concerned state was not keen on that because it goes to Kaveri and then it also helps some other state. So it tried to have a restricted link that would bring that water to the Bangalore city. So Mangalore, that is not in agreement, Bangalore getting that water. So this is where we lead to when we try to very get into sort of parochialism. And I would have what I have, and I would not share what I have, even though it is surplus. So this is, of course, social, and we have also a certain role because we are also part of that social group. We have to do it effectively, but capacity is there. Other things have been achieved. The Chinese project of South-North Link, especially Yangtze with Yellow River, it is a great project, and there are three such links, the upper, middle, and the lower, and they are doing it wonderfully. Of course, the way the China governs themselves and the society is different, but can we afford to be like what we are, only creating disputes, arguing, making if you are able to stop something from progressing, you get satisfied. So this attitude has to change, and we have to now learn how to be persuasive, how to take the help of India to promote this type of cooperative spirit, and together we can achieve a lot. That's what my thing. Interlinking of rivers is not a bad idea, but since it is going to cost us more, unless it this itself would compete with the other modes of capturing the fresh water. If there is any, that would also come part of it. And as it is, only after exhausting whatever is possible without interlinking, that should be done. But if there is, after all, that we are in a position to agree that there is a deficit or there is a surplus, how to deal with at national level, the nation should try to ponder over it. And in order to achieve it, the national government should have all wherewithals. And that is where these provisions or teething the central government becomes the sort
of
necessary.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much, sir, for the nice reply. Prasasis, will you finish?
Okay. Thank you, sir, for enlightening us on a very relevant topic, a new vision for system of water governance in India. I hope our students and our faculty members are really benefited from this important lecture. Now I request Professor Parida, Deputy Director IIT Roorkee, for final remarks. Please, sir.
Thank you, Professor Ashish Pandey. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. M. Gopalakrishnan, FNE, and who delivered the second Dr. A. N. Khosla Memorial Lecture of Department of Water Resource Development and Management. He is a great expert in the water sector. I attended his lecture. It was really very, very interesting, because water sector disputes, they come up in the open platform, and always there is a lot of concern with respect to different kind of conflicts, be it Kaveri Basin, or there have been a lot of other conflicts. And Dr. Gopalakrishnan has outlined very clearly how different strategies can be worked out that can be helpful as new governance. It seems very clear that there is a need for a new paradigm of governance, and which is going to be entirely different from the way we are handling. I'm not an expert in the area at all. I'm just a civil engineer. I can appreciate the subject well. When I try to draw a similarity, the total transport network, the road network in the country, is like 33 lakhs kilometer, out of which the national highway is 1.3 lakhs kilometer. And somehow, fortunately, there has not been any dispute with respect to usage of the road transport network. But then today, besides the road, you have rail transport, you have water transport. Water also is used as a transport, it can be used as a transport medium. And I understand, the need for water is there for urban areas, it's there for the agriculture, there is a lot of pressure. And whenever there is any dispute, it looks like any civil war is going to erupt. It's a very sensitive subject and needs to be handled very delicately. And yes, as suggested by Dr. Gopalakrishnan, that in the process of governance, it's just not the government, but besides the government, there are other stakeholders, the people, those who are the primary stakeholders, they also need to be taken into confidence. And one thing that I could understand in the entire deliberation, that there is need, we need to have a multidisciplinary approach. It's just like water resource engineering or hydrogeology, they are not enough. We need to go much beyond these two subjects. We need to look at river ecology, agronomy, soil science, social science, and management. Our department of WRDM like focuses on your agrometeorological field unit, where we try to collect this agrometeorological data and try to share with the rural villagers. By that, they understand exactly how to optimize the amount of irrigation they are bringing in for agriculture. So one thing is that, like, we need a great amount of multidisciplinarity in understanding this integrated water resource management. That's one. And in the Department of Water Resource Development and Management, we have many students from international background. We have students from Africa, we have students from Southeast Asian countries. Traditionally, we have a lot of students from Indonesia, from Burma, from our neighboring areas. And the practices, the kind of approaches these governance models, whatever we are talking about, like if they can appreciate, if they can adopt some of these models while they are returning back to their country, that's going to be very, very useful. And I must congratulate the department for organizing this second Dr. A.N. Memorial Lecture. First was delivered by Professor K.G. Rangaraju. In the same series, we had another eminent expert, Dr. M. Gopal Krishnan, FNE. He has a very distinguished presence in the water sector and delivered the second lecture. So I wish that the department continues the same spirit of organizing this endowment lecture series and engage with eminent experts from India, from abroad, for delivery of the lecture. And it's going to be very useful for understanding the pathways for the growth of the department. So with that, once again, I would like to thank Dr. A.M. Gopalakrishnan. I'd like to thank Dr. Kansal, Dr. Pandey, Dr. Khare for providing me this opportunity to be part of this lecture and share my thoughts. Thank you. Thank you, Ashish.
Thank you, Professor Parida, for your kind remarks. Thank you, sir. Now I request Professor Deepak Khare for vote of thanks. Please, sir.
So, thank you, Professor Pandey. It's my proud privilege to propose a formal vote of thanks on behalf of the department, on behalf of the institute, to Engineer M. Gopal Krishnan, FNAE ex Secretary General ICID and IWRS as well, who delivered a thought-provoking lecture on the one of the most important topic, a new vision for system for water governance in India. I am sure, sir, this lecture would be very useful in understanding various issues related to water security, water management. You have very clearly explained water governance structure of the country. In addition to that, you have dealt so many other issues like water, national water policy, national water framework law, even the water in constitution. So, in addition to that, the river basin management and authority, especially the two-tier system. So I think these are the things which we really get the exposure, ILR. So thank you very much, sir. We are thankful and encouraged by your stimulating and nice and exhaustive lecture. Department of WRDM, IIT Roorkee, always be grateful to you, sir. I am also thankful to Professor Manoranjan Parida, Deputy Director of the Institute, for his kind presence. In fact, Professor Parida and Professor Chaturvedi, the Director and Deputy Director, they are really helping and encouraging all the departments to organize such technical activities. In fact, the idea of starting the endowment lecture series started from our director, Professor Chaturvedi, and who suggested that in the name of the eminent personalities, the department should start the lecture, and it is going very nicely. And as Professor, you, Professor Parida, has also appreciated that this is the second lecture and it is of the same tune as last time. Last year we had Professor Rangaraju, and this time you are here, sir. So once again, I am thankful to Professor Parida for giving his consent to, and his gracing the occasion. We are very much thankful to all the guests, engineers, and faculty, and students from various departments for attending the lecture. I'm thankful to staff and students of the Department of WRDM who have contributed for the successful organization of this memorial lecture. We are thankful to the media for giving coverage to this event. Last but not the least, we are thankful to one and all those who have directly or indirectly contributed and extended their support for successful organization of the lecture. Thank you. Thank you. Namaste. Jai Hind. Over to Sir Ashish.
Thank you, sir. Now I request all the faculty members to please switch on your video so that we can take a great photo. Please. Idia, Kasi. Mishra, sir.
I think this is a good opportunity because on the online media, we can have only the group photograph here like that.
Yeah,
group photograph.
And very easy to take the photograph.
You can see the Ashish, the entire group.
हाँ हाँ सर बिल्कुल नितिन फोटो ले लिया आपने नितिन
हेलो
हाँ नितिन फोटो ले लिया आपने
सर हाँ ये सर सभी का हो गया सर
ठीक है थैंक यू वेरी मच
थैंक यू एवरीबॉडी फॉर माय पार्ट दैट आई थैंक यू एवरीबॉडी फॉर अटेंडिंग दिस लेक्चर
Thank you sincerely for facilitating this lecture.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.